Hopefully one day I'll. First, I would like to thank Dr. Avanindra for this opportunity and also the scientific committee. And just before going to this, there is nothing to disclose financially. And of course, there is one disclaimer I have to make. See, everything is fair in war and love. We have to include surgery also. Everybody has got his own technique. So when you say I do this, yes, fine. So whatever you do is fine. Whatever we do is fine. It's just a sharing of experience. And before going to the talk per se, I would like to ask how many techniques are there in this after Gaber? Just a guess how many modifications have been made so far. Come on, somebody say some answer so that we can move to the next. 12, okay. So there are almost, I was searching the literature, now we have got more than 22 modifications of what Gaber has done actually. So initially he was using Synthol, now we use Hammam, Lifebuoy, everything. So it's nice actually. So I'll skip all these things because Dr. Ritesh has discussed everything. So these are the surgical options we have in case of aphakia, either because of the nucleus drop. So we go for secondary PCIOL. This is my most preferred technique. If there is a capsular support, just because I do SFIOL, I don't do it. If there is an adequate capsular support, if it is even 2 millimeter, 2.5 millimeter, my first choice is keeping the lens in the sulcus. That's more physiological and less traumatic, both for the surgeon as well as for the patient. We don't do ACIOLs anymore because ACIOLs, if done in an uncomplicated eye, it's fine. But most of the time, these cases are done in complicated eyes. Iris suture, I'm not a great fan of it because we have seen a lot of iris sutures over a period of time dislocating. And what we do is no flap, no suture. And this is Dr. Gaber Scariot. He was the one actually who gave this idea of that IOL can be fixed to the sclera way back in 2007. And he got the best video award for this in, I think, EVRS or U-retina. And I had the opportunity of, I think that particular picture is missing good. opportunity of working with him. So we are going to just make this into five simple steps. The first one is once we are going to make a scleral pocket. So what I usually use is initially I was using troker, but now I use a 23 gauge MVR blade. You can use 25 gauge MVR blade also. It should be 180 degree away. And somebody was asking like, do I prefer 3 and 9? No, I don't prefer 3 and 9. For me, it is 8 and 2 or 4 and 10. Because at 3 and 9, you have long posterior ciliary arteries. So when you're entering, there is every chance that we can injure and we have the bleeding. So I always prefer 2 and 8 or 4 and 12. And we make this 1.5 millimeter posterior to the limbus. So we make the scleral pocket. This, I think, is the graphic. 1.5 millimeter posterior to the limbus at around 2 o'clock meridian and 8 o'clock meridian. Take your MVR, and the most important thing is the MVR should be directed towards the center of the cornea, because the haptic is like this. If you're going away from the cornea, there is every chance that we'll be having tilt of the lens. To avoid the tilt, better we go for. And we don't go through and through. Even the graphic says through and through, we never go through and through. It is just maybe 6 or 7 millimeters of pocket we make. So next one is, this is in case of, scleral tunnel. So your choice actually. If you're going for a foldable lens, you can go for a clear corneal tunnel, or if you're going for this, I always prefer a rigid lens for this technique because my experience with foldable is not that great. In the sense, the decentration and tilting is much more common. So what I prefer is I go for a regular scleral tunnel. Now the third step. Once we do it, at the edge of the tunnel where we have made, take a 24 gauge intramuscular needle, just enter into the vitreous cavity on either side. That's it. So it's, if it is, it should be as close as possible to your tunnel so that it's easy for us, so that there is no haptic is exposed. And the most important is the fourth step. So three steps over, excisalization of the haptic. So the forceps which I use is the one which has been designed by Gaber. It is a set of two forceps costing around 7,000 rupees. One is curved, the other one is straight. The straight is to go into the deep into the vitreous cavity and we can pick up. As Dr. Avanindra was earlier telling, the most important thing is to hold the tip. Never hold the shaft of the haptic. And this is a very nice forceps. You have got a claw here actually. So it's like a claw. It holds nicely. Even though they say it's a disposable, we can use it for, if maintained well, at least 50 to 75 cases without any issue. and not very expensive also. The most important is always hold the tip and never hold the, never hold the shaft of the haptic. Once we do it, yes, you just hold it. And this was done with the engine T system, which is very difficult for anti-segment surgeries. Okay, just excise. Unlike the other techniques, what I usually do or what most of us do is, we just take the first, tuck the first haptic into the, you can use the same curved forceps of a gabber, tuck it into the scleral pocket we have already made, done. So this is the first step. And the most important thing is, because I am a posterior segment surgeon and the vitreous cavity is almost 3.6 ml in volume, I am more comfortable tackling the second haptic. But as told earlier, if you are an anti-segment surgeon, if you want to tackle it anteriorly, you can do it in the AC also. So this is the step number four. What I do is the excisalization of the second haptic. So we have already entered. Through the same, you go with a straight forceps. And you can see the vitreous cavity, So as I have told, I am a posterior segment surgeon, so I am quite comfortable. So what I do is, you can make out, I just go inside. In fact, I was not using biom also. I was holding the tip of the second haptic. You can make out. So it's the tip. Again, never hold it with the shaft. The tip is held and excise. While excising, there is always, it is always better to give a counter pressure. If you see, once the eyeball is made, taut. So what I do is, usually I use a second forceps in my hand, usually a forceps, yes. So I press it on the posterior lip so that there is a counter pressure, excising the haptic is much easier. So this is a curved forceps, once it is excised, then interlaced through the same. So there is no flap, no glue. In fact, the other advantage is we can do it conjunctively also. You need not always raise the flap. And you can use for all type of lenses. So this is a complete video of a case where there is a posterior subluxation of the lens. We are making two ports with 23 gauge MVR, 180 degrees away. It should be 180 degree. I never measured because I am a bit overconfident. In case if you want, you always measure 180 degree. And if you see, I don't do at 3 and 9 to avoid the bleeding. I go at maybe 2 and 8. And once it is done, I think we have done the scleral pocket. And in this case, actually, I don't want to do the lensectomy. It might be time consuming for me. So you just go for a lavitation of the lens. Just remove one of the troker, preferably the dominant troker. Use a Sinsky. Yeah, I use usually Sinsky. Sorry for the wrong shape of the Sinsky. It has worked a lot for us. So just bring the lens into the anterior chamber. If you want, you can do some vitrectomy behind before delivering. And this is the usual thing. Once it is done, as Dr. Amanindra was telling, the most important thing is to address the vitreous. We don't need to go for a complete vitrectomy, but clear the vitreous at the 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock meridian and 9 o'clock or 8 o'clock meridian, so that when we are excising, there is no traction on the vitreous. We don't do, and you can inject the TCA also to look for any remaining vitreous. And this is what I was telling, to make an entry into, you just make an IM needle, exactly. So just to find out, with the iris repositor. So adjacent to the tunnel, it's fine. You just enter, then we use the gabber's forceps. In fact, most of our fellows use the regular 23 gauge forceps also. That's also fine. And it's a three-piece rigid lens. Hold the tip, never the shaft. And as I was telling, I just drop the second haptic into the vitreous cavity. So the thing is, you just tuck it. Because once it is stuck, there is no way that your lens is going to dislocate. It's going to be there. The second haptic, you can see, I am holding it with and using the counter pressure, using the forceps just to excise. And the thing is done, actually. Fine. So these are some of the post-ops where you see a nice centration of the lenses. Okay, this I'll skip. These are some of the cases where we have done. The advantages is like, it's almost similar to all these SFIOL technique. But there are some complications. So this is one of the complications. I think the most important thing is here, the wrong complication is, if you see the ports actually. So I think it's done by one of our fellow, I think, because if you see, the port should be closer to the section and never towards the thing. So I don't have much space for me to, you can see it's so messy. When I am trying, I usually hold the rectus muscle for internalizing the haptic. But here the space is so narrow, it's very difficult. So port making is very important. And then this is the question which was asked actually. So we have done, entered. I have done the second optic or haptic also. Now we can see actually the AC is filled with the blood because it is at 3 o'clock, probably I would have injured the. Usually this blood goes off and sometimes it remains in the vitreous cavity, maybe by 15 days it's fine actually. So this was tackled with thing. This is another case where it's already dislocated into the vitreous cavity. So what happened is we tried fixing the same haptic. But the problem is you see actually the haptic is already broken. This is not sufficient. So if you're going to tuck another maybe 1 or 2 months, it's going to again, dislocate. So what we did is basically we're not happy with that. So finally I just, removed it and we replaced it with a new lens. So this is what I was doing, just remove it. So in case if the haptic is broken for more than 1 or 2 millimeter, never hesitate, throw that lens and go for a fresh lens because we're going to use a PMM lens and you don't need any extra inventory. So always keep a backup lens, and if the haptic is broken, never hesitate because you're going to have a complication later on if you're going to insert the same lens. And these are some of the complications, and I think in this case, after doing everything, we were over-enthusiastic. So we tried inducing the PVD. Now we can find out there is a break superiorly. So while doing the vitrectomy, we have to be very careful because there's every chance that we might end up in doing a vitreous, the rectal break. Then once the rectal detachment happens, our personal experience, it's very, very, very difficult to manage these sort of rectal detachment. They never settle with single surgery, rarely. And this is one of the long-term cases where you can see it was not tucked properly, it was exposed, and this was actually leading to endophthalmitis. So every technique has got its own share actually, but these things can be overcome over a period of time. And in this basic thing is like, it's a very simple technique. You don't need to have any extra inventory. Maybe the only investment will be the forceps, no glue required. Otherwise everything is fine. And for all scleral fixation technique, AC maintainer or vitreous infusion is mandatory. And it allows a successful, whenever I feel a three-piece lens dislocated, I feel very happy because the same haptic can be, IOL can be fixed. If it is going to be single piece, then we'll have to remove. And in case of nucleus drops, same combination gives a single thing. And you don't need to have a special inventory for this. Thank you.
Many people complain that if you don't suture the sclerotomy with the vicryl, you land up with hypotony. So what's your experience with, or anybody in the audience have this experience of hypotony post-operatively?
Actually, in fact, most of our cases, because of the irritation of the ciliary body, had high IOP on post-op 1. Very rarely we come across this hypotony, unless otherwise. I think the hypotony is more because of not properly closing the sclerostomy post there than the port through which we externalize. So usually they close well. So we never had a hypotony.